Hello. I'm sorry. I had a phone call which I didn't know was going to happen whilst I was eating my cereal, which was already delaying the stream. But we're here now. Let me make it so you can see me end the game. That'd be a good idea, wouldn't it? Boom. Hello. Motorsport Manager doesn't fit very well around a webcam, so I've added Twitch chat above me so you can see yourself. So who knows? Maybe this will go up on YouTube at some point. But hopefully you guys are all okay. Today, just streaming some Motorsport Manager. I've been doing a BMW Let's Play in my own time. I've tweeted a little bit about it, but I've been having quite a lot of fun with it, so I thought we'd bring it back once more. So I hope the music's at an okay volume now so I can be heard over it. But yeah, great to see so many of you guys in chat. I do appreciate you tuning in. Obviously, it's been a little while since I last streamed. And obviously, I've not streamed Motorsport Manager before, but this is a game that has slowly consumed a lot of my free time. So I thought we'd stream it today. If you have any questions, I guess to start, I'm trying to think where to begin with this. I guess I could talk about what I've done so far, because obviously, as you can see by the year, I'm in 2023. So I've played like a lot of years of this of this save. I started back in 2016, so I've done 7 seasons. This is my 8th season. I played a lot of this game. I'm going to be pro at this game soon. But yeah, you can see I started in Formula E, which is like the third tier of racing in the ICE mod, which is the mod I'm using. Had 2 years in IndyCar and we got promoted to the F1 Championship Series, but F1's a bit of a step up, as I discovered, and it's taken me, well, it took me, as you can see here, 4 years to get my first race win. But this year, the chairman, he wants top three, which is going to be a challenge, because we've not got the greatest car. It's not a bad car, don't get me wrong, but it's not perfect. So hopefully you guys enjoy, hopefully you sit down. I'm not very happy with how my car looks this season, I'm going to be honest. Do I pay? Let's just change it now. What colours do I want? I don't want to have a bad looking car. That's the problem I've got. Yeah, you've got to have... I mean, none of them look fantastic if we're being completely honest. Some of them look like they were drawn by like toddlers with crayons. I mean, maybe red and black. It's not very BMW. That's the only thing. I mean, kind of limited on the colours. I don't want to go with it. That's bad. Let's just get rid of it. That never happened. I did not even think those colours would work together. But yeah, hopefully you guys are okay. I'm going to be streaming for the next few hours, I think. The Brazilian Grand Prix qualifying's on at 3 o'clock, so I'm probably going to head off before then. Obviously, there's football on today, but there's no Premier League football at lunch. So I might just... red and black... I don't know, it'd be a bit extreme after one race into the season to go from blue and white to red and black, but that is something that I might do here. What did I say? I meant Russian Grand Prix. What Grand Prix did I say? What colour did I don't know what colour I said. My brain. Still kind of catching up with the day. I've not been up for very long today. And, Mario Kart 8 came out yesterday, so I sat and played that for, like, a stupendous amount of hours. I said Brazilian. I don't know why Brazilian... I think we'll go with red and black. I think we'll do it. Why not? What? Dark sponsor colour. Do we have any sponsors on dark areas? It doesn't look like it. Right, we'll go with this. Red and black. That's better than what we had before. It's at 1 PM. That's 3 PM local, isn't it? See, I'm a shambles today. So the Russian Grand Prix qualified sooner than I thought because I forgot to do the conversion on time zones. I went, oh, it's on at 3 o'clock. That'll be local time. I'm not a very smart man today, as you might be able to tell. It's Mario Kart. It's taken over my life. But anyway, yeah, we're doing this. We're going to be doing the Dubai Grand Prix here, which is one of the trickier ones because the track's really long, which means you don't get as many practice laps in to configure your setup. I mean, I'm a shambles today. If it wasn't apparent that I'm not quite, like, awake today, I feel like it probably is now. In terms of car setup, I've not got many new parts because it's the start of a new season, but I'm working on the rear wing at the moment because that was something that I just didn't develop last season. But yeah, we'll see how we get on today. Hopefully the stream looks okay. Yeah, I've not streamed Motorsport Manager before. It's a bit annoying because you can't do custom resolutions with it, so in order to fix that and to have it so my face isn't covering anything important, I stuck the Twitch chat above me so that you can see all the information in both corners. Because I don't know where I'd put the face cam to not cover important stuff. Mario Kart is on the Switch. Yes, it's Mario Kart 8, but it comes with all the DLC. But I never had the Wii U version. I never played the Wii U version. In fact, I don't feel like I ever played on a Wii U. Which, I don't know, that's not exactly surprising, is it, really? Anyway, that's our setup for today with the car. So the way I like to do this, I'll give pro tips like I know what I'm talking about because I've done a few seasons now, so I feel like I have some ability to kind of say how I do things. So basically I'll set up two, both drivers with kind of opposite setups, and then from there I can work out kind of a ballpark area of where I need to change things. Actually they've both got a low handling, let's change that, let's put that handling up on Sainz's car. That might be too high now, but we'll find out. I feel like waiting till after your exams for a switch is like a smart decision. That's the kind of decision that I should have made when I was like doing school still. I feel like I wouldn't have been able to make that decision, I would have just got one. Believe me, you didn't miss much on Wii U. Like, genuinely, I don't think I ever played on a Wii U. Like, if I had friends who had Wii U's, they just didn't admit to owning one, which, I mean, I can't really blame them for not admitting to it. I probably wouldn't admit to owning a Wii U. But I'm really enjoying the Switch at the moment. Yeah, it's really good. I like the portability of it. I'm someone who likes to sit in front of my PC watching streams or just working on videos or just having FM up. So to have a setup where I can just, you know, have my Switch in front of me whilst doing other things is really, really great. Yeah, I played a little bit online. I won my first race this morning, and it was one of those ones where you red shell the guy in first who's been in first for the entire race as he's about to cross the finish line, and then you go past him, and you just know he's salty as hell. Like, it's one of those ones where it's like, I really wish there was voice chat for this, so I could talk smack and listen to this person complain. But we'll see how we get on. I played a bit of the Splatoon test fire for Switch, where they did kind of the test thing for it. That was really good fun, actually. I hadn't played Splatoon 1, so I'm looking forward to Splatoon 2. It actually comes out on my birthday, so that works out really nicely. Mario Kart 8 coming out on... When will it be? Well, it's on a bank holiday weekend, and then Splatoon 2 coming out on my birthday. It's like Nintendo want to please me as a Switch owner. Joseph watching a stream on Xbox One. I have an Xbox One. I don't know if I've ever watched a stream on it. I feel like I have and it didn't work properly. I think I might have watched one of the Counter-Strike Majors on it. But the thing is, because I have like two monitors at my desk, I quite like having a stream on one and then being able to do something on the other. And I feel like when I'm watching something, like most of the streams I watch tend to be like competitive esports events or whatnot. And I find that when I'm watching them, I want to be able to check Twitter and stuff at the same time. And to kind of see how people are reacting to it all, because I feel like that's... It's like when you watch like a football match on and you're on Twitter, you know, looking at what people are saying. I feel that there's some added enjoyment there, I guess. Maybe that's just me. That's how I spend my time watching streams. Just not watching the stream, just doing other stuff. Right, Hashi, what's wrong with your car? She's not happy with any of her car. This is just not good, is it? It's just not cricket. We'll go with that. Seems like our two drivers actually have pretty different setups on this track, which is interesting. I kind of need these setups to be pretty close to perfect. Because of how big this track is, I need to do my next set of laps needs to be on the race trim. Like, they need to be race stints, so I can improve that race trim. Which means that they're probably not going to be able to come into the pits again. I can still refine it, I guess, a little bit in qualifying, but we'll find out. Yeah, hopefully you guys are all good today. Thank you for the host, Venom. I do appreciate it. Is it Venom? I feel like it is. Unless it's Venom. It might be that. I don't know. You've probably never said it like that or heard it said like that before, but I apologise. I'm terrible with names. Like Hashimoto I struggle with. I just call her Hashi. Or Hash Brown. I do love a Hash Brown. Confessions with Jack here. A hash brown is like the optimal breakfast. Like a cooked breakfast without a hash brown isn't a cooked breakfast to me. It's just not the same. I've gone on a weird tangent there about hash browns, but it's a serious issue that I think has to be discussed. You know, we shouldn't sweep under the rug the issues of hash browns in society. Is the audio balance okay with the music and stuff in the background? I've got the game sound turned off just because I find that the engine sounds and stuff are just a little obnoxious. Okay, these setups aren't too bad. See, I'm not a black pudding fan. I'm sorry. I hate to be the bearer of bad news. I am not an advocate of the black pudding. Is that a problem? Like, should I stop streaming now? Is it? Maybe that's just me. Music's a little low. The music's always difficult to balance right, because you kind of want it where you can kind of hear the music rather than it just being background noise. But at the same time, you don't want it too loud. Right, our setup's pretty solid here. I was a little bit concerned about getting this car set up, but I am a lot happier where we're at. Hopefully we get really good setups here. Unfortunately, Ashley likes to burn through her tyres way quicker. I'm offended black pudding is bae. I don't feel like I'd had black pudding before. I went to Glasgow last year. I was helping out on the set of Time Commanders. If you ever watched that TV show on BBC Three, they did a reboot on BBC, or on BBC Two, the original series on. They did a reboot on BBC Three, which I was helping with the filming of. I don't think I'd ever had black pudding before. If I had, I'd just avoided it because I didn't think it looked that nice. But I decided to have it in the bed and breakfast we were staying in. Wasn't a fan. I hate to kind of say I wasn't a fan, but I have to hold up my hands and admit, just not a black pudding guy. I tried it twice. You know, I wanted to like it. I will say it was my first time in Scotland. Very nice, Glasgow. Right, let's just get this race trim knowledge up now. I'm going to leave these drivers out for the rest of the race so I can just get on the beach and have a sunbathe. If you make it right, then it's amazing. But then it was in Glasgow. There was a place I went to in Glasgow, and I'm not going to be able to describe where it was. It was near like a shopping centre, and it was near a Greggs and a Kickers, and it was this like burger bar place. They did the most insane burgers you've ever seen. Like, you know, you get like highly stacked burgers that sometimes get dished out to you, and they have the sticker on. You think, oh, am I going to eat this as a burger? Imagine like one of those, but it's like twice as tall as what it should be. It's like 6 inches tall. No, taller than that. I don't want to say a foot tall. That would be exaggerating. But it was a big burger. That was my highlight of Glasgow, was this burger, though. It was incredible. Wasn't meeting Greg Wallace. He was average. But the burger. I don't know what the name of the place was, though. I just know it was somewhere in Glasgow, and I've given a very rough description of where it was. Anyway, cars are actually setting fairly decent times. We are predicted to come third in this year's Drivers' Champion, in the Constructors' Championship this year. We came third last year in it when we weren't predicted to come third. But we have quite a good car here at BMW. It's a well-rounded car. Don't really excel anywhere, which is a little bit of a problem. But anyway, hopefully these setups are good. Signs is excellent, excellent, great. Great, great, excellent. I will take that. That's pretty good from the few laps that I had of actual practice because of this track. Did I get full racing trim? I didn't. No. No, we got so close. I'm just sad now. Is the game like an okay size for you guys to be able to see what's happening? I'm a little bit conscious because obviously I've got the issue whereby the game doesn't have custom resolution, so I've had to kind of scale it in a little bit and then put the Twitch chat in so it all fits. But yeah, hopefully it's all kind of readable. It should be fine. I mean, you've got it at the same size that I've got it at, so we'll see how we get on. Do I want to tweak these setups? Probably not. Although I know that the handling just needs to go down a tiny little bit to get it to excellent. I don't know if I'm going to be able to do that without throwing off the speed balance. I don't think I am. That might help. Yo! Totally a botanist. Thank you for subbing, my friend. I do appreciate it. I don't stream here nearly enough, but your support is very much appreciated. But yeah, thank you for subscribing. Can we get some hype in the chat? Well, I don't have a name for my subs. I'll call you a spaceman. You're a spaceman. That's the best I can do. We don't have the budget for a better, more original name. But I do appreciate it. Thank you very much, dude. Hopefully you're enjoying the stream. Hopefully you're enjoying the video content as well. Right. Signs, need a good race from you today. I think we can do two flying laps. We've got plenty of tyres because the regulations, like the teams all voted to have loads of tyres available like recently, and they've also made the races shorter. So the teams in this game have actually annoyed me a little bit. So if you don't know Motorsport Manager, there's like votes that are carried out kind of season on season, you can call a vote. And in the last few years, we've had like 15 tyres per race weekend approved, shorter races approved. Yeah, there's been some really annoying ones that have kind of been approved. The other one that's been approved is this kind of shorter qualifying session. I can't wait to find my dad to let him know I become a spaceman. Well, congrats. We don't have the budget to send you a spacesuit. You have to provide your own. As well as a rocket and stuff. Right, I'm looking for good flying laps here from Sainz and Hashi. Make something magical happen for us. As I said, I think we might, because I sent them out so quickly, have time to squeeze in one more set of flying laps on fresh tyres. We'll see. It's gonna be a challenge. I want to finish in our sponsor objectives at minimum this kind of race with at least one of our drivers. That's the aim that we have to hit. Right, I mean, we're the fastest at the moment. Doesn't really mean a whole lot. Although we do still have the two fastest, although Agnostopokal, I don't want to offend any Greek viewers, but this guy, we'll call him Agno. It's definitely not how you say his name, but Agno, he's leading the way. Giovinazzi in the Ferrari is setting a fairly good first sector. Second sector's a bit meh. Hamilton squeezes in. Giovinazzi knocks us down. Right, I think we have time for another set of flying laps here. Now, someone told me that apparently track grip isn't actually implemented in the game yet, which makes a lot of sense because it's never really felt like it made a massive difference to me. I just assumed I was going crazy. But apparently that doesn't actually affect anything at the moment. Apparently. I mean, you guys can let me know if that is or isn't the case. I might have been lied to. I've had little lies told to me in the past. That's all I'm going to say on the matter. Right. Can we get these flying laps in? We're going to get them in comfortably. If we get held up by people going out on outlaps when they're never actually going to be able to set a time, I'm going to be mad. If they block Hashi, I am rioting. Because you've set your drivers out with 50 seconds left of the session. A lap takes a minute and 40 seconds. Look at them. Get out of the way. Actually, she's not actually going to catch them up. Use their slipstream. Maybe. I think we're going to be okay. What times? Okay, we improve with both drivers, I think. Either way, fourth and fifth. That's not bad. Not bad at all, although Agnostopopoulos. I'm just going to offend people. Nice to see your love of the Japanese has moved from FM to Motorsport Manager. It's true. What save was it where I had loads of Japanese players? And what? No, it was the World Cup. That's how it began. It began with the World Cup because I was like, Japan became my second team. I will say that this person, Chiaki Hashimoto, isn't actually a real driver, apparently. Apparently, it's just added into the game with the mod. But she's a very good driver, so I'll take her. Right, race day. See, as I said, the tracks and laps and stuff are shorter this year because the teams voted for them. We could actually do a no-stop strategy on the soft tyre with signs. I think we'll go for that. Hashimoto is going to be having problems because her tyre management is awful. So I think we'll do double super softs on her. The only annoying thing is that I didn't actually develop the soft knowledge. I could go with Pit Stop Guru, but he's not actually going to pit. Doesn't really make a difference. What I should do, actually, this is the second race of the season, so reliability is really, really bad. So we are going to probably have to pit anyway. Now I think about it, I might want to pit signs unless I really think my car can last the entire race without a pit stop. I don't think he can last the race, you know. I'm going to change that. I'm going to change him onto the super softs. I feel like both drivers are probably going to have to come in for repairs at some point with this being the second race of the year. Right. We can push pretty aggressively, I think, to begin with, because we're going to have to do a pit stop at some point. So it's going to be Tony Agnew at the top, Lewis Hamilton in second in the Ferrari, Giovinazzi in the Ferrari in third. We have fourth and fifth lot down. Mercedes then have Max Dorni, Joseph Newgarden and Sorokin for Red Bull in seventh and eighth. And then the Force India and, Max Verstappen in the McLaren. Right. Let's see how we get on here. Okay, so the group doesn't do anything. Thank you, Fenham, for the knowledge bombs. Right, oh, okay, well, that's the perfect start. Let's go, Carlos. Hashi, I'm just going to pretend you don't exist because you've dropped down a load of places. I hope that's okay. There's no driver in the car. Dun, dun, dun. I don't know why I leant in there like that was going to help me. Okay, so Sainz back down to fifth. Hashimoto down to eighth. See, there's a few cars running the medium tyre and a few running the regular soft. They are going to be trying to do a no-stop strategy. I don't think that's going to work here, though, because it's the second race of the year. So, like, park condition and stuff is just awful. I also need to be aware that the tyre temperatures are going to get pretty high here because we are racing in a desert. I would say that it's pronounced Agnostopoulos, but I'm just a botanist spaceman. Right, can we get some praise for Hashi in the chat? She's struggling. She's down in ninth. What are you doing? Right, Carlos, I'm just... You're down in... whichever one I look away from, they drop down places. I just need to pick one to stay looking at. I just realised I forgot to turn on Kurs onto auto. So we just had a lap without Kurs, or what's it called in this, ERS? It's not called Kurs anymore, I'm a few years late. Or at least we've got loads of it stocked up now, right? Definitely not my fault that our drivers dropped down places. So yeah, tyre temperatures are going to get pretty high here. That's more of a concern for Hashi than it is for Sainz, because Sainz, like, he's going to have to pit at some point. His rear wing is still very much a development in progress. Hashi's got the knowledge on as well for half the time for parts to be repaired. So she's actually in quite a good position whereby if parts do start falling apart, we can kind of pit her and it isn't quite as punishing. She's up to eighth now. I was about to say she's down to eighth. I mean, it still feels like she's lost places, but she's doing okay for us. This is a really short race, though, in terms of laps. There's only 12 laps, but it's a long track. I feel like we can probably push the drivers here, because I'm going to want to pit around lap 6, although I guess I don't want to have to double stack, particularly if there's repairs that need to be done. The dilemmas. I mean, Sainz is still in 6th quite comfortably at the moment. Whoever it is in 9th, Studzinski, I can't talk, he's holding up the entire pack in behind. They are all bogged down behind him. Which, I mean, is great for us. Because it means that Hashi's not really got anyone on her trail. And actually, it might create a little opening for Sainz to drop into. Although Sainz has just been overtaken by Sergio Perez in the Force India. I mean, we're being overtaken by Force Indias. It's all going wrong. It's all going wrong. Right. We're up to lap 6. 7 laps left. I'm going to push Sainz for the next lap. I might pit him this lap. If I don't pit him this lap, it'll be the lap after. I think it'll be the lap after this one that he's on. But that's when we'll pit him for parts, I think. But I'm just going to push his tyres, because otherwise both tyres drivers are going to fall off the cliff at the same time. And also Sainz, he's pretty good with his tyre management, so I'm not too concerned about him as much as I am with Hashi's tyres. Although, I think Hashi has just fucked up her tyres, because they seem to be degrading as quick. And also, Sainz has got a rear wing problem, which I knew was going to happen. We're going to have to fix some parts here. I don't want to fix the gearbox, because that's like takes the longest to fix. The rest of the park condition isn't too bad, but we're only halfway through the race. Brakes and suspension. I think I'll do that. I'm going to risk the engine, the gearbox. The front wing I could also replace, but that's actually got quite decent reliability. Oh, for sake. All your cars are fine and then they all break down at once. The issue I've got is if I pit Hashi now, we're gonna have to double stack. Her car is too badly screwed up in too many. In fact, the whole car needs just fix the whole car. It's gonna take 29 seconds because she's got decent knowledge, which reduces the time for fixes. What parts did I select to be fixed here? Because now that Hashi's car is gonna fall apart, that might impact how much I'm willing to fix. 23 seconds. What's the difference between them? 8 seconds. I'm sorry, Hashi, you're going to be held up in the pit for like 15 seconds. So this series, it's using the ICE mod, and I started with the BMW Formula E team. So yeah, I started down in like the third tier and I've worked my way up to Formula One. We're in the year 2023. This is really annoying that I've got to stack my drivers. Please. Please go. Okay, it's okay. I don't know how long Hashi was held up there. So 39 seconds in the pit lane for signs. Although Hashi has the knowledge for faster repairs. Did you know the game has a dormant code for car spins and sprinkler rule set? That's pretty cool. I made a list actually at one point of stuff that I'd like to like added to this game because there's so much that, I don't want to say it's missing, but stuff that can be added. Alright, our cars now need to really kick on. Thing is, everyone else is going to be pitting soon. So I want to use this clean air in front of us to just get as much speed as we can. Hey, Erotic Carrot Cake, what's good, dude? Good to see you in the chat. Like, I'd really like to see car reliability issues in practice sessions and qualifying sessions. I'd like to see more dilemmas where you can try and get a driver to fix an issue with a part in the car rather than having to come into the pits. So say you could make some kind of decision where you can either pit to fix a gearbox or you can tell your driver to not use fifth gear, as an example. And obviously that could have positive and negative impacts in different ways. There's so many little things you could add to this game that I imagine will be added either in future iterations or through updates. See, I feel like all these cars are going to have to pit. There's no way they're going to last. I mean, Hamilton's retired with a mechanical issue. I feel like we're going to have quite a few drop off here. I mean, it's going to be mad if these guys try and finish the race on these tyres. Because they've still got, what, 2.5 laps of one of the longest tracks in the circuit. I mean, we're slowly just creeping up the position by virtue of the fact that everyone else's cars are falling apart. Hi, Jack. I have a question. Where's Curry Dog? He's on my desktop somewhere. The photo of Curry Dog. Hashi's up to 10th. I feel like these guys are going to have to come into the pits. If they don't, I feel like their tyres are just going to fall off a cliff. And actually, Sainz is catching them. Agno is loving it on the fresh tyres. So it's the final lap. These guys, they've done such stupid strategies. And Sainz's car's falling apart. And what part is it now? Okay, it's the engine. Nobody panic. But we might have an engine issue. We're up to 7th, though. Believe. Don't blow up, engine. Please don't blow up. Please don't blow up. I can't believe these guys have not had any reliability issues in the second race of the season. I felt sure that everyone was going to pit. I mean, he still could... Oh! Who's that? Is that Giovinazzi? It is. I mean, we'll take 6th, I guess. Where's Hashi? 9th? It's not great. We're trying to finish top 3 this year in the Constructors. So really, we need to be getting kind of 5th and 6th. I guess 6th and 8th isn't too bad. That's pretty cool that people have got it so cars can be taken over and rebranded. I can't believe these guys made it work. I mean, their tyres must be on like 10%. I feel like one more lap and we would have had them. It's a little bit annoying. Yeah, I made a notepad document at one point of stuff that I feel like could be added to this game. I really wish I could find it. It had quite a long list. It was just something I did just in my own time. Like, I'd like to see proper telemetry where you can compare drivers' laps, and then maybe you can advise your driver on a specific turn that they're struggling with. So, you know, you could look at your two drivers. You might have one driver who's setting the fastest laps, but they're losing time to your kind of other driver. And I'd like to see, like, more breakdowns of, you know, sectors and stuff. So I know in F1 this year, in real life, obviously, you've got the new additional sector split. So rather than it just being three sectors, it's like every so many meters, you now get splits. Stuff like that would be cool. And then you could maybe have it mapped out as a graph, like a line graph, so you can see where two laps were versus each other and where, you know, time was lost and gained by each one. I do wonder if part of that is the limitation of the engine at the moment itself. Like, for the game, I imagine that stuff that just probably would take a hell of a lot of work to even get working. You mentioned about working up to F1. How does that work? I thought teams just got bought in and stuff. Yeah, they do in real life for a lot of the time. The way it works in game basically is, with this mod that I'm using, it adds Formula E, IndyCar, and then Formula 1 as kind of three tiers. That's never really how it works in real life, but it's just the mod itself. But basically, when you win a championship, you get given the choice of, do you want to be promoted, yes or no? And obviously, there's advantages to going up in terms of there's probably more money available. At the same time, the disadvantages are, it's, you know, you're going to basically have to start with a new car to fit in with all the regulations. After needing to make some rather hasty repairs to the brakes in the pits, I'm going to piss off the chairman. Screw him. I'm a terrible owner. Is Veshaw in this mod? I feel like I've seen that name. Should we have a look? And now I'm 99% sure that they are in this. I feel like I've seen them. This year I've got is all the younger drivers. Yeah, here he is. He's not that great, unfortunately. But he is in the game. So he got dropped by Red Bull, having never made an appearance for them, and currently he's racing in Formula E. Just a shame you can't become a drug overlord and buy in. It is a little bit of a shame. Scouting. See, I was looking at Agner here. I was curious how good he was. He's not actually that great. Broke up with teammate. Wait, you mean that he was dating his teammate? I assume it means that he left his previous team in IndyCar, rather than he broke up with a female teammate. I don't think I'd allow that in my team. We can't have any working relationships. It's a bit annoying. My drivers are pretty good. Unfortunately, Sainz, he's got a dodgy neck at the moment. Otherwise, his fitness would be, I think it would be actually be 19 or 20. But he's really good in game. And then Hashi, who we've got, everything but her smoothness is great. But the fact is, smoothness seems like such an important attribute from like my kind of time playing this game, just because it can make the difference so much when it comes to tyre wear. I've also got Newey here, who is a sponsor driver, so I get paid actually if I race him. He has room to improve. If he reaches his 5-star potential, and we're getting paid £800,000 per race, we're going to be laughing. My teammates are dating. Funny thing is, they're both male. Amazing. Right, we have a new sponsor, and actually, I think this is a big sponsor. So we've got 5-star sponsor appeal, and this is slot 2 of fixed payments. Look at that money. Look at that money. The question is, who gives me the most money long run? Oh, I hate maths. $2 million per race. Per race. I need to work out which gives me the most money per race on average. One sec, I need to get the calculator out. I feel like an accountant. Need to work this out. This is important now, boys. We need as much money as we can have. Right, so 8 million up front. Plus. And then it's going to be 1.4 million times 24. So that's going to give me £41 million total. The Pirelli one will give me, I don't even need a calculator for this one, £42 million. So that one's slightly better. And then there's this one on the right, which is a longer deal, but is a way more fixed money. So I need to work out per race what it's going to be. So 42 divided by 24 races. So per race, I get £1.75 million from Pirelli. Lucas are going to give me £20 million plus £64 million. I mean, this is going to be comfortably them, isn't it? I can already tell. I don't know why I've got the calculator out. And then divide that by 32. They're going to be 2.6 million per race. Well, that's an easy decision. I didn't need that. Right. There we go. New sponsor. That's going to be some really decent money per race. And also, if we look at my headquarters, I'm currently building a road car factory, which is giving me about £800,000 per race extra on top of that. So we're actually going to be making a lot of money. Because for the last few years, I've not been making money. Which has been annoying. I've actually been losing money year on year, and basically sponsors have kept me afloat, whereas now I can actually start to invest into loads of different areas. I mean, we've got the best medium speed corners, but everywhere else we suck. Got very serious there with the calculator out. I felt like an accountant. It's terrible. Scouting report's completed. He's terrible. What other drivers we got? I can't remember which I've looked at here. Terrible. I think I just scouted all the drivers. Not bad, but 20 years old. Tony we've already looked at. T-Dizzle, as I like to call him. Terrible. These are all terrible, aren't they? Yeah. Okay. I'm pretty happy with our current drivers, to be honest. I don't feel like we need to worry about changing it up. I really struggled to make money, though, during the first few years in Formula 1. It was really bad. I hate reliability at the start of the year. I feel like they could rework this slightly to make it less terrible. Because it's kind of just frustrating, I feel like, to begin with. Do I want to develop another rear wing? Like, as I said, the last few years I've not been developing my rear wing, so that has actually caused me some problems. They all have risk levels. I might do one of those at the end of the year then. Acceleration's good. Top speed could be better. We're still fourth fastest. It's just the fastest cars are way, way faster. I mean, these components are so bad. There's actually no good engine components this year, at least not for the first few tiers. It might not be an engine yet. I could go all out on getting this up. Would make sense. Get a really good gearbox. I think we'll go with that. Hashimoto's avatar looks like the token one. They have to tell you. They have to say about races and drama and Need for Speed games. Yeah, was that Need for Speed 2 where they had that? I do know what you're on about. I never played Need for Speed Underground 2. I think Underground 1 was the like one I played the most before all the open world stuff came in. Does science have a future in the music industry? I mean, you tell me. Apparently Carlos Sainz, he's all about the music. He's loving it. Got a wet race coming up. It's in Russia, my word. Look at that. What are the chances? When's our next sponsor? Okay, so Oz Racing is going to expire in one race. Hey Rich, how's it going, dude? I really enjoy Motorsport Manager. I've been doing it like once a week on my channel. And loads of people have been going, Jack, do it more often. But I'm quite enjoying having it as a series where I just kind of do one video a week. It's something that people can just look forward to on the Sunday or Monday. I feel like, I don't know, maybe it's just me. I feel like there's a few series that I watch on YouTube that are once a week, and I know I always watch them because I look forward to them because they're only on once a week. Loads of people are like, yeah, do two a week. I feel like people might stop watching it then, which might seem really counterintuitive. Like, why would people stop watching it if they're asking for more? But I know that there's some series that I just kind of struggle to keep up with on YouTube. Right, we have a new gearbox, but it's nowhere near ready to be used. But we do have our new rear wing, which is good. It's a bit of a shame that I can't upgrade the engine this year, or I could, but the upgrades wouldn't be particularly useful. So heavy rain on race day, clear practice, and qualifying sessions. We'll see how we get on. Going to Sochi, although of course it's not Sochi, just for any legal teams watching from Formula One, this isn't Sochi by any means, it just has a long sweeping left corner. Hey Kevin, appreciate you watching, dude. Hope you're having a good day. So yeah, this definitely isn't Sochi with a long left hand. I just noticed all my drivers have 20 feedback. Part of me feels like I should be letting Harrison Newey drive in practice to help him develop, but also because we get paid £400,000 and he has really good attribute for giving feedback, so there's like no reason not to. Right, so we'll go with that for Newey, and then for Hashi it's going to be kind of the reverse. I think we'll go with lower handling, and then we can cross-reference results. I must admit, I'm a little bit annoyed by the fact that the current championship rules mean that you can have 15 tyres, because it means I just pretty much use softs. I will be going to watch quali. It's at 1 o'clock, isn't it? When I started the stream at 11 o'clock, I thought quali was at 3 o'clock from Russia. I didn't realise that was 3 o'clock local time. I just assumed it had been converted because I'm a silly person. So I have to live with that mistake now. But yeah, I probably will be heading off to watch quali today. I might stream this though a little bit later this evening. I'm not sure yet. I'm just glad people are enjoying watching the stream as it is. I really enjoy this game. It's a nice change of pace. I've been playing it a fair bit around Football Manager. I've been having just a little bit of a break from Football Manager as of late. No one's really asked, Jack, where's Kingston Sprint? But basically, if anyone is wondering, where's the Kingston Sprint series? I'm sure there's one or two people watching the stream. I've just been having a little bit of a break from Football Manager in general, really. I've got a backlog with the Hereford series, so it's not so big of a deal for that series. I will say now, I've signed two new designated players at Kingston Sprint, and my word, they are like ridiculously good for MLS. Do I want to give them as exclusives? Why not? So it'll be coming probably Monday or Tuesday next week, the next Kingston episode. So the two DPs I've got, Sadio Mane, 26 years old, barely played for Liverpool in the save, so straight in the club. And I've also signed Batshuayi from Chelsea. So I've got kind of two players who are in their mid-20s, really hitting their prime, playing in MLS, which is great. And the reason I was able to afford that is because if you've been watching the series, you'll know, haven't really spent that much money. It's been a lot of free transfers and stuff I've brought in over the last few years. Anyway, let's see how we get on here. So speed balance is way off, so we'll lower that. And then handling will put up. And it'll be another lap of qualifying just on the same tyres. So, I hate it when you get good in a load of areas. Especially when you don't know whether you now need to move them up or down. I can guess. So I guess that's what we'll do. See, I think that setup is probably going to end up with loads of excellence. I'm going to call it now. Newey is going to come back in with excellence after this stint. So I think Mane I got for, I want to say 6 million. I can't remember. This was like a week ago now. And I think Batshuayi was 8 million. And that's dollars as well, not pounds. So they'd both be up there with the most expensive MLS players, really. But, I mean, if you look at Atlanta, who we took over, like, they signed, I can't remember the name of him, the Paraguayan player for, like, $7 or $8 million. Jack, how many hours did you spend preparing for the Kingston sprint save? About 50. Probably more than that. It took me 2 weeks of testing and doing it because there's so many weird rules. Like, if you watch the video where I talk about the database, I kind of mentioned some of the weird bugs I had that I had to work around. Like, stuff that you just... They're bugs that occur because, well, firstly, no one would ever put a Jamaican side in MLS. Like, it's just something that wouldn't be tested by the foot guys over at Sports Interactive. But secondly, because... a lot of stuff's hard-coded into the game with MLS, which you can't really change, which is a little bit annoying. I didn't notice what new he had for his stats. I said that he'd end up with free excellence. Did he get good? He got great. Do I have a Patreon? I don't. Loads of people have... Well, I say loads. A few people have asked me, like, should you, like, set up a Patreon and stuff? And part of me's like, yes, this is a great idea. I should set up a Patreon. But because of the fact I work full-time and stuff, I feel like I might struggle to provide what I promise in terms of the different, like, levels, if that makes sense. Obviously, people want to have really cool incentives to donate, and, like, I'd never put my content behind a paywall. That's just not a thing I ever want to even consider doing. But, I don't know, I feel like if I was to start promising a load of stuff, and there's a pretty good chance that with my work and stuff, there'd be weeks, months where I can't, like, offer what I promised. I guess I could change it and go, you know, promise within my means. But then I don't know if people would actually want it that way. Because I feel like with Patreon, you know, you want good incentives. I feel like as people who enjoy my content to kind of donate towards it. I know, and obviously, if you just wanted the content, you can get it for free. I kind of get that. I feel like, I don't know, maybe, I feel like with Patreon it's a bit, I feel like it requires a degree of commitment towards the gold stuff that I don't know if I could maintain, in all honesty. And so rather than go, yes, you know, donate to Patreon, if you donate $100 per month, I'll get a puppy. And then I don't get a puppy. I don't know, I should look into it more, I really should. I always feel a little bit funny about asking for money. I mean, when I stream stuff, I assume it's still set up, actually. There's, like, a donate link below. And, like, donations are really appreciated. But, like, as I said, I don't want to put my content behind a paywall. Like, I always want it to just be available for anyone to watch anytime. Like, I'm fortunate, I guess, in the sense that I know a lot of people who have Patreon and stuff. You know, YouTube is their sole source of income. It is what they spend all their, you know, their time doing. It's like a full-time job for them. And Patreon helps to basically supplement it into becoming a full-time job. Whereas for me, you know, I work full-time, so I don't rely on YouTube for anything. I do YouTube because I enjoy it for the most part, because I enjoy creating content people like to watch. So I feel, I don't know, maybe it's just because I have a slightly different mindset. I there'll be some people who go, you know, Jack, you should be, like, if you can make money off it, why wouldn't you want to? I guess that is perfectly kind of legitimate. It's just kind of, I don't have that mindset, I guess. You should definitely get a puppy regardless. I know some streamers on YouTube have a £1 Patreon as an ad block absolution. See, maybe I could do something like that. I feel like the idea of Patreon is, like, fantastic. I just don't... And to be honest, if you were to search Work the Space Patreon, you would actually find a Patreon page I set up a little while ago. And the point at which I set that up was I'd graduated from university. I was living with my parents and I did not have a job and I could not find a job at the time. And I was, like, completely lost. And it was just like, right, I'll set up a Patreon and hope, you know, if people want to donate eventually when I, like, shout it out and stuff, then fantastic. And then I never actually ended up having to plug it because I got a job working at Football Manager as a game tester and ended up moving down to London, and so the Patreon wasn't, you know, something that I had to worry about. I don't know, I should look into getting a Patreon at some point. I feel like I've just taught myself into setting one up. I guess that there's, like, pros and cons to it. I guess I talked about the fact, you know, I have a job, so I don't rely on YouTube as a source of income, which is great. I guess the counterpoint to that is that the amount of work I put into YouTube when I come home from work is essentially a part-time job where I get paid below minimum wage. But the amount of hours I put into like my YouTube videos, recording, actually playing the games to record the videos and stuff, I've never done the maths, actually. I bet if I did the maths, it works out like for every hour that I spend recording videos, I'd probably make £2. But then, as I said, I don't do it as a source of income, really. I do it because I enjoy it. I really should get a puppy. See you later, James. Thank you for watching, dude. Right. I feel like our knowledge is okay. The wet race can make things really interesting here. I do want to get a puppy at some point, for the record, but my current flat that I live in doesn't allow me to. That's the other thing, actually. Like, when I think about it, the current flat I live in, the reason I moved into it is because it has, well, there's a few reasons, but one of the big ones is it's big enough for me to have my own little recording space where I'm sat now to do my videos and stuff. And the walls are really thick, so I can record at any time of the day, whereas, you know, if I had a house share, you know, I'd probably get interrupted mid-recording and stuff. And so it's never really dawned on me, actually, the fact that I probably pay more than I should for my flat because I look for somewhere where I can record videos safely. Get a cat instead, Jack. Genius. I'll get a cat and a puppy. Maybe I should just set my Patreon incentives as I'll get a goldfish every time we hit a landmark. If you donate $50, I'll get a goldfish and name him after you. I mean, maybe people would don't. Maybe that's genius. I'll write that down. So, £50 per month, goldfish named after you. I feel like that would just end up being abused. All it would take is like, I mean, maybe it's genius. Maybe one millionaire just goes, yeah, here's £1,000 a month, just 20 fish. I can supply kitten. Right, Paul, where do you live? I'm turning up now. How many fish can you like put in it? Like goldfish can you have together? Like before they start attacking each other and stuff. Questions that I've never considered. I'll give you £50 if you get a goldfish named Bucket. Genius. Some people name their regens after donors. I'll name goldfish after it. We'll do weekly vlogs with the fish. I'll set them all up with their own Twitter pages where I'll post unique tweets from each. To be fair, that's not dissimilar to stuff like, I'm trying to think of it, you know, like where you can sponsor like an animal at a zoo or like a wildlife rehabilitation centre. There. That's a big word to say. It's not actually dissimilar to them. It's like, we'll send you a postcard and stuff. A goldfish and a cat, what can go wrong? We didn't do very well, did we, in qualifying this session? I've been distracted, although Sainz is about to better his time. Go on, Sainzy boy. He's in seventh. Where's he going to finish? Seventh still. Well, I've just tried to build up a load of hype there, and it's just been killed. I'm really hoping for a wet race. That could really help us here. For ages, I didn't upgrade my forecasting centre here because I just didn't think it was worth it. If you play this game, upgrade your forecasting center. Just do it. Right, I think we're going to be okay unless Alashin, who I don't even know who he drives for, it must be one of the terrible teams, is going to pass us. So we did hit our sponsor objective, so that's good. Unfortunately, Agno, he won the last race. He's pole again. It's all going wrong. All going wrong here. Any predictions for the race? If you've got any, get them in. Oh, it's Dr. Bet. Look, he's got a tick. Hi. Oh my god, I've got a tick too. Is that the real Dr. Benji? I don't have to ask that anymore. I already know it is the real Dr. Benji. Jack, do you often interact with other FM YouTubers besides Ben? Does Proudy count? Probably not. He does like one video a month. I don't. Well, I do and I don't. Like, there's people who I will talk to, and I feel like it's a bit weird for me, because when I first started doing FM videos, like, kind of everyone knew everyone. It was kind of, I don't want to say it was a lot more of a community, but you kind of, I couldn't. It was plausible for you to know every single content creator and kind of talk to them on a regular basis. Like, we did stuff like the FM Cup back in 2014, and there was probably only 8 or 9 content creators. Whereas I feel like now there's so many more content creators, and it's a little less inclusive in terms of there aren't 8 people kind of doing it. And I think there's a few reasons for that. Obviously, the inevitable one is it's got bigger. There are just more people. Obviously, the more people you have, the more likely you are to have, you know, their own little cliques and kind of groups emerge. But I think the other thing that's kind of changed slightly maybe is the attitude between different content creators of different sizes and kind of different types of content. So when I started, it was kind of interesting because content creators, for the most part, you knew them all, and you were all within a few hundred subscribers of each other. And, you know, everyone, you know, networked really well with one another. And I guess as, you know, people's channels grow and others don't grow, kind of divides and cracks start to show a little bit. And you get people who get jealous of one another. You get people who, I guess, become paranoid that other people are just leeching off them. And I'll be honest, I'm guilty of that to a degree. And I guess for, like, with the example of me and Ben, I've known Ben before he was doing YouTube videos. We were friends, like, outside of kind of YouTube. Me and Ben don't talk to each other because we're content creators who play FM. We do it because we're friends, like, we've known each other years. And I still keep in contact with the people who, as I mentioned, when I first started doing my channel, I still talk to people like Mick, Jakey Cave occasionally. You know, the people I talked to when I began with, Jubb even, you know, I try and keep in contact with them, and I probably have more interaction with those kind of guys, the people who kind of started making content at the same time I did, than the content creators who, you know, spring up seemingly on like a monthly and weekly basis now. And I kind of feel like, I guess to a degree, because I don't talk to smaller content creators, because there's so many of them, and because with me working full time and with me doing videos, I don't talk to any content creators really, other than the ones I'm just friends with. It's tricky. I don't know. I feel like perhaps those people go, oh, well, you know, these bigger content creators, they're not talking to me because I'm a smaller content creator. And so they have this, I don't want to say state of mind, but you have that mentality of, oh, well, they think they're too good for me, which really isn't the case at all. I should be on the wet tires, not the inters. And it's a little bit unhealthy, I guess you'd say, because, you know, people draw these divides, and it's kind of weird. I guess to an extent, I am responsible for creating my own divide, in the sense that, I don't talk to many content creators at all. I mean, I'm quite friendly with a lot of content creators. We did stuff like the FM League before, and I don't have any beef with content creators. You know, it's not, I very rarely talk to them, so I don't really have any reason for confrontation for people. I think a lot of people think they know me as a content creator and just assume that I think I'm too big for them because of the fact that I don't talk to them, which isn't really the case. Does that make sense? I feel like I've just gone on a waffly rage. I've just realised, okay, we're okay. I was panicking that we pitted onto the wrong tyres. I really should have set all my mode to low. In fact, I can still do that now. I was too busy waffling along there. I wasn't really paying attention to the race. Did that make sense to anyone? I hope it did. See, I'm thinking we stay on the wet to one or... Well, it's going to be about 3 or 4 laps. All these guys staying out on dries are playing it very, very brave. What's happened here with the safety car? Are we racing here? I feel like the safety car's glitched out, you know. Because I don't think we're racing here. In fact, I know we're not racing here, but the safety car... I mean, it's heading to the garage. What's happened here? I'm so confused. What is happening? Why did everyone just get let past the safety car? I mean, are we trying to catch the safety car? I mean, this can't be a flying lap. My brain hurts. Was this a bug? Have I gone crazy? I mean, we're in second somehow. I'll take it. Safety car's going in this lap. I mean, I assume this time we are going to pull up behind the safety car for the last half a lap. Okay. I need to pay attention there. So we're going to be on aggressive tyres to get the heat back in. And then we're changing both tyres to medium. Right, go onto the medium mode. Unfortunately, I left my engine mode in high for way too long here. Right, go on, Carlos. Have a go it in. Ashley's down in 8th, less than ideal. Well, the question is, when do I want to pit here? Because we're on full wet. The track isn't actually going to dry out that quickly. No, overtaken in sector 2. New Garden's crashed. I'm really paranoid. I'm going to check the chat and miss my drivers crashing. We can be really aggressive on these wet tyres. Okay, it's going to be next lap that I pit. I think we've got to go. How many laps are going to be left? So there's going to be 8 laps left, or 7 laps left. Hashi's going to be running really tight on those tyres. YOLO. How's our park condition? I should probably have checked that with Hashi's car. Science has the car that I've been working on reliability for the most. Right, let's see how we get on here. Carlos, make something magical happen for me. Just do it. I need some Carlos Sainz magic, please. Are the other drivers going to pit? I might be pitting too soon. Is anyone else pitting? No one else is pitting. They're all staying out in the wet. Oh, no. Is this going to pay off? I might have just ballsed up both drivers' races. And Sainz had a bad pit stop, which held up Hashi, and we got double stacked. Why? Why? See, a few other cars have now gone onto the softs. I mean, we'll not, I can't believe Sainz screwed up his pit stop. I mistimed the pits. That was one mistake. I think we might be okay here. I think we might have pitted at just the right time, he says, as he cries slowly into his hands, knowing that he hasn't. See, the track's not that wet. I mean, Sainz is in... Alright, what's your... that rear wing has just fallen to bits. I can't pit you, Hashi. But the rear wing does really impact. 6 seconds for a stop. I can't afford another stop. Hashi's race is over. She's ruined it. Right, YOLO. No rear wing. You're going to lose loads of time. See, Sainz is in fourth. I've not actually lost that much time, considering that we fucked up a pit stop. In fact, I kind of feel like there probably isn't a lot of difference in the time that we pitted. How much time is Hashi losing? She doesn't seem to be losing any time. He says. Okay, she is losing time. She's losing a lot of time. Well, YOLO. We'll just focus on Carlos. Hashi's race is over. She's got to stay out if she wants any points. Although there is a bit of a gap behind her. We'll pit, just because I think she's going to drop out the points anyway. It's a 9 second stop. Do I want to change tyres? I might as well. And then she can go on attack for the rest of the race. Pray for Hashi, everyone. She got held up by a double stack that went wrong. And then her rear wing fell off. I don't know. I'd be interested to know. I didn't pay attention to how much that fail in the pits stop impacted us. But I'd be curious to know. Oh, the gear. I can't pit for a gearbox. Can he pit for a gearbox? That's a long stop. Does changing the engine mode affect the park condition quicker with stuff like the gearbox? Does anyone know? I mean, Hashi's in 12th. I don't think she's going to make up those times, but I feel like she would have just dropped off anyway. What signs is condition looking like? Okay, the gearbox is screwed. a lap and a half car. Now he's 6%. It's all gone wrong. Just put it into low. Survive, Carlos. Survive. 6%. I believe you can hold on to fourth. Please, Carlos, do it for me. Do it for the fans. Who's this smoking? Okay. Oh, we're up to third. Go on. Go on, Carlos. I mean, we've got a podium. I'll take it. Considering the balls up in pit stop. That does make me wonder if the pit stop hadn't ballsed up, could we have got first? I'm sorry, Hashi. You've got 12th. I don't care about you as much. I mean, Sorokin won for Red Bull, with Kvyat leading. That is really unusual that those two drivers came out on top. Oh, that's annoying. I feel like we did the right thing in pitting when we did, you know. I think if we didn't have a pit stop balls up, we would have actually been okay. Which is a little bit sad. I feel like we would have probably got second. I mean, we still made four places. Hashi dropped three places, but sponsor objective was hit. And we should be making a lot more money with our new sponsor now per race, which is good news. A Russian 1-2 into Russia. I mean, fix. Someone call fix now. I can't believe that Sorokin won, actually, considering yesterday in the Renault, he wasn't even getting there. Well, I think he got two laps done in the practice session that he was involved in. I mean, we came third overall. £2 million made each race. That's really good money, because for the last few years, I've been struggling. Sorokin and Kvyat win. Signs lead to the Drivers' Championship, folks. That's all I'm saying. Have you seen? There's three Russians. Because Studzinski is a regen. Are they called regens in Motorsport Manager? Are they literally regens of retired drivers? I don't actually know how that works in this game. Studzinski, okay, he is a regen. Or a regen? Are they regens or are they new gens? What song is this? It's all got really angry. Oh, it's the Fall of Troy, right? Let's change. It's all got very angry all of a sudden. What music do I want to put on? Let's put on this. That's far too angry and aggressive. When I just want to relax and play Motorsport Manager. Car condition update, not great. Eurosport, what do you want? You finished well down the pecking order in practice, only managed to finish 7th. Did you struggle? We had the engine turned down. Wink, wink. Pro tip. Just lie. That's what I've learned in these games, just lie to the press. Right, new part. Gearbox, acceleration. That's going to be finished after the race. But like mechanic mistakes should be toned down a little. Being punished for something that's out of your hands is frustrating. Kind of agree. Obviously, you can affect how effective your mechanics are with your staff. But I think it's a pretty valid point, to be fair. Got a pretty good designer. It's a shame his suspension's so terrible. Although suspension's actually one of our strongest areas. Yeah, I guess it's annoying when you have like a mechanic who has 20 in everything. And another one who has 17 in pit stops and you still get issues. What music am I into? See, it's a bit weird for me. I wouldn't say I have any one particular kind of genre of music I listen to more than another. I'm trying to think, what would I consider the music I'm into to be? I'm quite into my hardcore. Hey Bexy, what's up? I don't know, it's a good question. I'm into a bit of everything. I feel like if I went through my Spotify, it just wouldn't make any sense to any rational person who has a preference for music. Who do I want to be sponsored by? These sponsors are pretty terrible. We'll go with Microsoft. How many races? 24. Jack, is your donation page working? I think so. I've not tested it. If it is, let me know. Interesting paint job, straying away from the classic of BMW, blue and white. See, I went with blue and white when I was in Formula E, and then I went with it when I was in Indy car racing, and then I switched to black, red and blue for a long while, but this year I've just gone with red and black. But we are in the year 2023, so, you know, it's developed over the last 7 years. What's this vote for? What do we want to vote for? We want to remove the Portuguese Grand Prix. Is it bad that I want to vote for it? Is it bad that I want to vote for it? I voted for it. I don't know why I voted for it. Are we about to remove Portugal from the Grand Prix? No. No, we're not. Oh, wait. It's deciding to vote because someone did a double vote. Wow. Well, I'm sorry to any Portuguese viewers. I've just got rid of your race. I feel bad now. I wonder if you could just get it so you just vote out every single race. I started this save in the third division, racing in Formula E. Our bonuses are really good now. I'm probably going to go with the Microsoft one for third and above, to be honest. So this race is being removed forever soon. It's the last time we'll be here for a while. So sad. Right, what do I want to do? I don't really need that many medium tyres, particularly if it's going to be a wet practice. I hate wet practices. I forgot to change out what foot parts we're relying on to improve the reliability on. That wasn't very clever. Mistakes were made. Hey, Gemma, what's up? Can you check your donation page? Let me see if I can get it working real quick. I don't know why it wouldn't work. Are you trying on mobile? I've not actually tested this, so I have no idea. Last time I streamed, I think it worked. But then, last time I streamed was like a long while ago now. I feel like there were problems donating on mobile before that someone mentioned. I'm going to donate 50p to myself to see if it works. I feel like there is just a test button I can use. I mean, this is really sad, isn't it? I think mobile might be the problem. I wonder if it's possible to modify the tracks of the real F1 circuits. It would be cool, I think, to have the real circuits. It's interesting, actually, because obviously there are some tracks which do kind of seem to steal a little bit of the design of the actual track. So, for example, I was just in Russia, and it does have like a long left-hander, like the one that goes around the the main bit of the Olympic complex on the actual track. But then there are others where there's just no resemblance whatsoever. Sauber have announced they're switching to Honda next year. I don't even understand. Why would you do that? I feel so bad for McLaren this year. Have they gone through all their power units already? I feel like I have done, and I feel bad for them. We'll use Harrison Newey again to help him develop, but also because he's a sponsored driver and I want money. And he has 20 feedbacks, so there's like no reason not to use him. I am using a mod actually at the moment for all the real car models and stuff. Oh, are they? I didn't realise McLaren was switching to Mercedes. With the Van Dorn thing where he switched his power unit 5 times in 4 races now, obviously, is it a 15 grid penalty? If they switch it again, is it a smaller penalty, like a 10 place on the grid or a 5 place on the grid? I don't know how that works. Answers on a postcard, let me know. I assume he doesn't get a 15 stop penalty for every time they replace the power unit, otherwise what's the point in turning up this season? And also, haven't they switched to the new power unit for this weekend? I know they were testing it and they had problems there. I don't understand, because my understanding, obviously I don't watch that much motorsport really. I follow F1 a fair bit. My understanding is Honda basically rebuilt their engine from the ground up to just shave weight off it, similar to Mercedes' engine. And that's where all the problems are coming from. Someone can probably tell me if that's right or wrong. I can't imagine it's a 15 grid penalty for every single time. I feel like I read it's 5 places for every time he now has to replace it above that limit. But yeah, I do feel bad for Van Dorn. I mean, you must be thinking, why the fuck am I turning up? Because his race weekend's basically over, because he's going to be starting at the back of the grid anyway. Hi, Benji. I'm not watching the old firm at the moment. I could watch it. Oh, is it raining? Really? Really? Raining practice? I'm not going to switch because it's going to be a dry race, according to the weather people. And the weather people never lie. I feel bad. I feel more bad for Alonso, but at least he's escaping to Indy car racing for the Indy 500 for a little while. Okay, it's not a terrible first setup run, because Newey's pretty happy with his handling. Just the downforce, and I know where that needs to go. I'm feeling pretty good about this race weekend. I think this is going to be a pretty good setup for Harrison Newey. He could get pole, start 16th. It's the sad reality, isn't it? I do feel bad. It's bad to laugh, but I feel like the issue is okay with the whole kind of Mercedes situation at the moment. I want to laugh at them and I want to mock them, but it's just not funny anymore. Like, it's genuinely depressing for both drivers that they're having to put up with it. Like, I'd be losing my shit if I was like Van Dorn. Like, what are you meant to do? You've gone through 5 power units in 4 races. I mean, I assume it's too late for Honda to go, yeah, let's just go back to last year's engine. Because they've invested so much into this year's engine to shave weight off the power unit. To kind of match the Mercedes engine. I mean, I'd be mad. I feel like I should explain for people who don't watch F1 or follow it loyally. I mean, is there anyone who's confused by what I'm saying? Because I can explain it a little bit more. If there's anyone who's like, I just don't understand. Basically, the TDLR is Honda are one of the engine providers, and McLaren are one of the few teams that use a Honda engine this year. Honda have been developing a new engine for this season, and the engine keeps failing, and they had a new engine, you know, new and improved for practicing a week and a half ago, which blew up still. And well, McLaren are now on a new engine, but every time you replace the engine, you have to take a penalty of grid placings for the next race after a certain amount of like changes, and they've already had their kind of limit for changes. I feel like the downforce needs to be lower here. Oh, thank you. Wow, okay, it does work. Bogey on. Thank you very much, dude, for your £10 donation. I do appreciate it. I hope you're enjoying the stream. I hope you've been enjoying the video content and stuff. I really do appreciate it, dude. Thank you very much for watching, and thank you very much for your donation. And wow, look, it even popped up at the top. Look at that. I'm pointing the wrong way. Look up there. It worked. I'm a genius. Mercedes is supplying McLaren next year. Well, that's great news. Oh, Toto's just announced that. I wonder if there's some clause in the Honda contract about the fact that they can switch engine. I feel like you've got to have some kind of clause where after a certain point, like, there must be some, I feel like there must be a performance clause in there or something that means that they don't have to use that engine. I mean, if you've not written that into your contract, that's a mistake. Hey, I'm not going to be able to read your name. Vince. Peter, I don't know. I can't say username. Send help. There's a break clause at the end of this season. If they don't use it, they're stuck with Honda till 2024. Probably good to break that contract then. I mean, it's good news for McLaren. I guess the issue is now they're stuck with the wrong engine, well, with an engine that they know they have no future with. I feel bad for Sauber now, because I assume that that's going to have a negative impact on Sauber, who have now announced that they're using the Honda engine. Because, I mean, one would, I guess, maybe I'm incorrect here, I'd assume that Honda will be less keen to improve the engine for Sauber versus McLaren. That's true. I guess Sauber just need the money this year. I must admit, it's a little bit depressing only having 20 cars on the grid this year, and consider, you know, 24 drivers, 12 teams was kind of the norm for so long. I still feel bad for Sauber. Can we have a hashtag pray for Sauber in the chat? Yeah, I guess the Sauber, they're kind of stuck between a rock and a hard place. Because the Ferrari engine they're on at the moment obviously is not going to improve this year. I think qualifying will be interesting today. I don't know who was quickest in practice three. I kind of want Kimi to get on the front. I don't think it's going to happen, but I know he was performing well in P1. Well, hopefully we can get that race knowledge up and what's left of this session. Now I can just sit back and relax, you know, get a martini out, sit in a deck chair and just watch it go by. One engine explosion equals one prayer. It is weird, yeah, as you said, having the back market teams as Sauber and McLaren. I agree with that. It is really, really odd. Apparently Alonso to Renault is happening. Is that going to be at the end of the season or midway through? Are they dropping Palmer? That can't be happening mid-season, surely. Okay, that's an okay session. Did we get the race knowledge? We did. Hülkenberg's been doing really well with the Renault, to be fair, this year. I don't know how he's getting so much out of that car. So I made 12 teams in each tier of Motorsport Manager. That's interesting. I wonder if you could go like mental and have like a 30 car race. Palmer is shite though, let's be honest here. I mean, from my experience with Motorsport Manager, he's not been that great for me, I'll be completely honest. So with the sponsor I picked for this race, I am not expecting us to reach top four in this session. I'm expecting us to reach top four in the race, possibly. But we'll see. See you later, Italy Botanist. Oh, it's 7 a.m. I appreciate the commitment, dude. Thank you for watching. I hope you're well rested for working tonight. When did McLaren become so crap? They've not been that terrible the last few years, but this year they're on a Honda engine that just is really unreliable. Like, they've not been a top team in a long time, but they've never been as bad as they are this year. Palmer came last in P3. Oh, God. I don't know whether or not to laugh or cry at that. Bring back DiResta, that's what I say. Bring Paul back. Can we start a hashtag? I will probably try and get signed in my Renault playthrough. Well, I've got him here and he's been so good for me. Thing is, Palmer won't come last on the grid even if he performs terribly, because it's always guaranteed that Van Dorn will be. Okay, those times aren't that great. In fact, they're really not that great. We don't have the top speed, and this is quite a fast track if I remember correctly. We'll have another time for another set lap, I think. Yeah, we should all have loads of time. We can do another flying lap on both these. Let's bring back Crash Donardo. Make it happen. I'm looking forward to watching Quali in 15. I'm hoping we'll get this race done, because then I think I'll head off to watch the Russian qualifying. I think it'll be a pretty good one. I looked at Stroll this year in this BMW playthrough. I think he might have been demoted to IndyCar to drive. But I did look at him. He wanted a lot of money, though. Watch it on stream. It's not the same. I can't pay attention. I'll just restream Sky Sports F1. What could go wrong? Okay, Sainz has got sixth. Hashi, producer, magical Hashi for me. I mean, ninth is not magical. It's not magical at all. I do feel bad for Stroll. What about Carlos Sainz's crash last weekend, or 2 weekends ago? See you later, Bogey One. Thank you for the donation again, dude. I really do appreciate it. I hope you're enjoying the content. I think I saw that stat about Verlaine can create completing more laps than Stroll. Hey, SpongeBob97. I'm not too bad, thank you. Not too bad at all. You know, just enjoying my Saturday bank holiday. Just loving it. Loving it, you know. What more could you want? 3 days off. Mario Kart 8's out. Motorsport Manager now. Grand Prix. Football aplenty. Just perfect weekend as far as I'm concerned. Okay, so it's going to be a dry race. Unless it's going to rain right at the end, which it probably won't. Car setup, how long are these tyres going to last? 8 to 10 laps. That's fine. Hashi might have a little bit more of a tricky time. She's going to have to manage her tyres. But that's okay. I would love to see Alonso go to Renault. That'd be a really nice move. Part of me's like, I don't see it happening. The other part of me's like, make it happen. Alright, I'm going to start with Hashi's driving style on neutral, because I need her tyres to last. I feel like in this game, and there's a few people I know in the chat who play a lot more of this game, so maybe you know more than me. I feel like tyre temperature doesn't actually impact the tyre degradation rate that much in the vanilla game. Now, I don't know if I'm crazy here, but I feel like you are better off keeping your car tyres like running in the like low mode, or in backup or conserve, and having low temperature than you are trying to push them to get more to medium temperature and then keeping them there. Like, that seems to like degrade the tyres more. Maybe I'm crazy, maybe I'm wrong. That's just like from my own personal experience of playing the game. People in the YouTube comments every time are telling me, no, Jack, you've got to keep the tyre temperature medium to help the tyre deg. I don't think it makes a difference from my little time playing this game. And I mean, I've done 7 seasons now. Maybe I'm crazy. Maybe I am wrong. Maybe I'm just spouting kind of tin pot theories and I should get the tin foil out and wear a hat made of it. Let's see how we get on here. We're in 6th with Sainz, which isn't too bad. Hashi's up to 7th too. Sainz now into 5th. That's a really good move on Giovinazzi, because the Ferrari is one of the faster cars. Yellow flag in sector 2, Verline's crashed out. Well, we're talking about how many laps he's completed in real life. He's only completed one full lap here in game, in a sick twist of fate. Go on, Carlos, have a go at him. It's only Joseph Newgarden, he's terrible. Watch out. Okay, the Ferrari's now made itself his way around the wide. Oh, three abreast through the chicane. I mean, you wouldn't see that in real life. Let's be real here. Well, Sainz up to fourth, which is good. Although I should probably turn the tyres off high now, because I am just melting them and I kind of forgot about it, if I'm being honest. It should be okay. You should be able to make them last two or three laps, which is fine. You can see, like, Hashimoto was running in the neutral mode, whereas Carlos Sainz was on attack for three laps. And the tyre deg kind of condition is bare, like, not that separable. Like, that is the difference between good smoothness and bad smoothness, like having 10 smoothness and having 20. Do you know the trick about designing illegal parts towards this end of the season? Yeah, I have been using that quite a lot on this save, Hobbsy. Yeah, but I looked into that because it isn't really explained to you at the end of your first season what happens. And so I went on a little Googling spree trying to work out like what determines your car performance for the next season, and I saw the thing about, you know, like developing illegal parts is the way to go. Okay, I can't really... might have to double stack my drivers here. I mean, Hashi's going to have to go onto the medium tyres probably, which is a little bit annoying. I'm going to keep Carlos out for one more lap, which might be a stupid risk, but I think he has to do it if he wants to run two softs, because we don't have to change compound if we don't want to. IMO, it'd be sure for Alonso to stay at McLaren because they're never going to produce a better car than the supplier. And even if they do, their engine won't be equal to Mercedes anyway. Yeah, I kind of agree with that. Has Alonso got like long left on his contract with McLaren, do we know? I know it's not something that's really discussed about that often, is the length of driver contracts in F1. Yeah, the issue for Maldonado was he's not a terrible driver, just... No, okay. He's not a good driver, he's a great racer. That's what I'll say about Maldonado. Unfortunately, that did kind of cost him a little bit when it comes to racing. Okay, these tyres have kind of fallen off a cliff. Am I right in thinking about 20% condition is where the tyres really do fall off? I feel like that's what I read, and I trust it. Okay. Two drivers come out side by side. So Rotkin's ahead, and then it's all cars who haven't pitted ahead. We should be able to make these tyres last, I'm confident. Thank you for watching, AJs. I appreciate you watching the stream, dude. Glad you enjoyed it. I do feel bad for Maldonado. I don't think many people do. I am one of those people. I think we're in a good spot here. Giovinazzi's leading the race. I mean, he's going to pit this lap. It'd be interesting to see if he comes out behind us. I don't think he will. I think he'll be ahead. Okay, never mind. He must have had a bad pit stop or they're repairing a part. So the car's ahead. Sorokin and Newgarden in the Red Bulls. The Red Bull is actually slower than our car overall. Hamilton and the Ferraris leading the way. He had a few reliability issues in an earlier race, so maybe that can come and kind of benefit us. Hashi's so bad with her tyre management, like, seriously. I've got to put her in conservo, they're not going to last. Alonso's contract's still 2019, you see. I mean, I guess it's not out of the question that you'd go to Renault. The thing is, you don't really want an unhappy driver, particularly if it's someone who's just not happy with the car as a whole. Hey, we've got fourth and fifth at the moment. We're in a good little spot here, really. I've just got to watch out for Hashi's tyres, because she melts through them. Signs should be fine, though. Okay, that's worth knowing. Thank you, Fenham. I'm a little bit annoyed that a vote was passed in this save specifically for shorter races. I kind of wish they were a little bit longer, but I mean, what can you do? I guess a vote for them to be longer. I tried that last season. Wasted my vote. Feels bad, man. Okay, so there's 3 laps left of the race. Sainz probably needs to go on conserve, you know. Hashi has to stay on conserve too. I'm hoping I've timed this okay. I mean, we're fortunate, I guess, in the sense that there's quite a lot of breathing room behind Hashi. She's got, what's that, 9 seconds? Should be okay. I can't see Sainz catching up with Sorokin. I think 6 seconds is going to be too much to make up, although Sorokin did just make a mistake there. Right, last lap. What part is playing up? Gearbox and rear wing. That's not what I want to see. My GT career has 100 lap races. That's pretty sick. I should do a GT thing at some point in my own time. Okay, Sainz gets 4th. That's a good little performance. Hashi's going to get a 5th. Pretty good race. We're not the fastest car by any means, so I can be pretty happy with that. See, I can't work out if I like the Baku track or not. I really like the Castle section, and I quite like Sector 3, but I feel like the first sector was just a bit meh. It's a bit samey. Even kind of going into the early part of Sector 2. Maybe I'm being biased because my BMW car isn't very fast. So we did really well then. I don't know what happened to the Mercedes. Tony Agnew dropped 11 places. Giovinazzi and the Ferrari dropped 13. I can only assume they had some problems there. But, well, yeah, up 4 places, that's really decent. So Carlos Sainz still leading the way in the Drivers' Championship. Sorokin only 5 places behind, and then it's Studzinski. 15 points behind, so we're leading the Drivers' Championship. Constructors as well, we're not doing too bad at all, we're in second there. That was pretty decent. I'm pretty happy with that all in all. I'm, I think, going to wrap up the stream here though, guys, because I want to go watch the Russian qualifying session, and I'm probably also going to catch the second half of the Premier League games, or one of them that's on. But I do appreciate you guys watching. Hopefully you enjoyed this Motorsport Manager stream. We kind of hovered around just over 100 viewers, which is better than I thought we were going to be at, to be honest. And I'm glad that you guys enjoyed it. It was good to get some discussion as well going on about the F1 in the comments. It's always good fun. I might stream this again soon. If you guys enjoy it, we can definitely look to do this some more. I will probably look into doing the Patreon and donor stuff that I mentioned earlier on in the stream. I will probably also upload this to YouTube maybe as a VOD, because obviously it has the Twitch chat and stuff, so it's quite handy to upload to YouTube. I feel like if you're watching this on YouTube for whatever reason, let me know if you got to this point. Just write a comment about cupcakes. Just do it. If you're in Twitch, feel free to write about cupcakes now. But yeah, that's going to be all from me. Thank you for watching, guys. Glad you enjoyed the stream, and hopefully I'll see you guys on the next one.